Hi everyone, today I'm going to be discussing redox stratification, specifically the redox tower, different metabolic redox potential differences, and how these different metabolic pathways can be seen in different microbial communities, and how these different microbial communities stratify in natural environments, and how we can use this to our advantage when reconstructing ancient conditions on Earth and projecting future conditions on Earth. So this slide is about the redox tower. So the redox tower shows the relative differences in reduction potential or redox potential of various metabolic redox pairs. And before I get to why that's important, reduction potential is just this E over here to the right of the redox tower, and it is the tendency of a chemical species to be reduced. And this is important for our understanding of how much energy certain metabolic pathways will yield. And so this is important for understanding how microbial and biological communities will interact with each other and what's kind of the hierarchy of different microbial and biological communities. And we can see here on the right that we have different pairs of electron donors and electron acceptors that I have paired up for you guys to kind of focus on for this video, because these are really common in natural environments. But before I get to which these pairs are, I want to explain a little bit about the reduction potential and which part of the redox tower is going to be more likely to be an electron donor versus an acceptor. So in metabolism, there's an electron donor and there's an electron acceptor. The electron donor is going to be the species with the lower reduction potential, so higher up on the tower, and the electron acceptor is going to be the species with the higher reduction potential, so lower on the redox tower. And this is because when you think of electron donor, they're going to donate their electrons to the other species, so therefore they're going to become oxidized. So they have a greater oxidation potential and a lower reduction potential, so they're a little bit more negative on this E value here, this reduction potential. And the electron acceptor is going to have a high reduction potential because it wants to accept the electrons and become reduced. So an electron acceptor typically that, for example, we use is oxygen, which is at the bottom of this tower, as you can see here. So it's a really good electron acceptor because it has such high reduction potential. And the difference in overall reduction potential between electron donor and acceptor is going to determine how much energy you get out of that metabolic pathway. For example, oxygen respiration gets a heck of a lot of energy yield because it has such a large difference in redox potential between the electron donor and acceptor. You can see they're on opposite ends of this tower. And then all of these other pairs that I put up here today are other metabolic pathways I want to talk about in this video, but I want to warn you that they don't always have to use glucose as an electron donor or organic carbon for that matter at all. There are microbes that use these metabolic pathways that can use inorganic electron donors like hydrogen, for example. And so I'm just using glucose as an organic carbon electron donor example for all of these pathways. So you can see how the redox potential differences relate to each other, meaning relate to the different metabolic pathways that we'll talk about. So the next one I want to talk about is manganese reduction. The manganese pair is actually unfortunately not shown on this tower, but it is somewhere in between the iron and the oxygen down at the bottom of the tower, and so it has pretty high energy yield in terms of redox potential if using glucose as an electron donor. And the next one is nitrate reduction or denitrification, both pathways of reducing nitrate as the initial step. Although I just noticed here that I mislabeled these, so switch nitrate reduction and denitrification in your brain right now on this slide. And the next one is iron reduction. Iron reduction is the next step up in energy yield. And then you have sulfate reduction, which I'm partial to because I think it's really cool because I study bacteria that do this metabolism. And lastly, methanogenesis, which is the production of methane by use of carbon dioxide and water. And methane on this tower is actually not shown either, but it is in between the elemental sulfur and sulfate on this tower in terms of reduction potential. So that's kind of what you'd get out of it in terms of energy yield. And so you can see all of these relative to each other are kind of getting less and less in energy yield. But basically, what I really just want you to get out of this slide is that oxygen respiration is the best, meaning we get the most energy yield for our respiration process. So for example, this is the redox potential difference between the electron donor and acceptor in this case. And this is to show how much less you're getting from something like sulfate reduction while also using an organic electron donor. So it's just to show that we make a lot of energy the way we breathe and metabolize. And so that's why maybe some microbes have really simple lives. Well, they aren't necessarily able to afford to live like we do. And we can live super extravagantly with a bunch of different functions because we have all this energy that we can make using oxygen respiration. That's because of redox differences. And so redox is super important. So next, I want to talk about all of these metabolic pathways in natural environment. So typically, redox stratification in natural systems can occur in water columns. If a water column is really stagnant, meaning no mixing, and so this is either called a meromictic lake in lacustrine settings, or a restricted marine basin in, say, for example, continental margins with lack of mixing and maybe over nutrient load, such as current dead zones that are forming right now. Those are causing stagnant stratification of redox zones in which microbial communities with different metabolic pathways can live in the different strata. And so things like this also in terms of sediment rather than water columns, which is more typical for Earth today, we can have redox stratification occurring in soil as well as marine sediment and lacustrine sediment. So any sediment that you can find probably has some redox stratification going on, because at a certain point in sediment, you're going to not have oxygen anymore because the living things that photosynthesize to provide the oxygen only live up on the surface where there's light. And then those living things that eat up this oxygen during oxygen respiration only go so deep into the sediment before they run out of oxygen. And so we have to have different redox zones with different metabolic pathways depending on what's available in these zones. And so it's pretty impressive how many different electron acceptors that nature has evolved to use. And it's also kind of crazy that oxygen respiration was one of the later evolved ones, even though it's more beneficial. But that just has to do with what was available on early Earth versus now, and so on. And so it's kind of cool how these things work themselves out in natural environments. And so, for example, I'm going to walk through this step by step. First, you'll have an oxic zone, the surface of whether you're talking about stratification of water columns or sediment, whatever. For this case, we'll just talk about the zones themselves. And so you'll have the oxygen respiration occurring in these zones. And this is when oxygen is reduced from a zero oxidation state in molecular oxygen form to water, in which it is a negative 2 oxidation state, which is most often the case for oxygen in compounds. And then you have nitrate reduction, which is the next zone. And during nitrate reduction, you have nitrate NO3 minus going to NO2 minus nitrite, causing the nitrogen in these compounds to go from a +5 oxidation state to a +3 oxidation state. You can also have denitrification, which starts with the simple step of nitrate reduction, but then goes further to completely denitrify the nitrate, meaning it causes it to form back into dinitrogen or atmospheric nitrogen that is released back into the atmosphere for nitrogen fixing bacteria to go and fix again into nitrate. But in this case, denitrification causes the nitrogen to go from a +5 oxidation state to a 0 oxidation state. Then below the nitrogenous zone, you have the manganese zone, or where manganese reduction occurs. And this is where manganese will be reduced from a +4 oxidation state to a +2 oxidation state. And below this, you have the ferruginous zone, where you'll have iron reduction occurring. And in iron reduction, you'll have the reduction of ferric iron, or +3 oxidation state iron, to ferrous iron, or iron with an oxidation state of +2. And below this, you'll have sulfate reduction. And sulfate reduction causes sulfate, or sulfur with an oxidation state of +6, to be reduced to sulfide, or sulfur with an oxidation state of -2. So this is quite a jump in oxidation states relative to the other ones. The last zone is the methanic zone, where methane is produced by the process methanogenesis, by methanogens. And these methanogens reduce the carbon and carbon dioxide from +4 oxidation state to a -4 oxidation state in methane. And I put this question here: did you notice anything significant about methanogenesis metabolic pathway? And this is to get you to think about, oh, we're turning carbon dioxide into something different here. So that's different than photosynthesis, which is probably the other one you've heard about that uses carbon dioxide to make something different, such as oxygen, which is nice. But methanogenesis, even though you can single-mindedly think about it as a way, maybe we can just put these microbes everywhere and they can take up the carbon dioxide that's in the atmosphere and kind of help reduce that and turn it into something else. But this is just something that I like to mention because it exemplifies the need for us to understand what we're doing when we employ carbon sequestration mechanisms, because in this case, we would be taking up carbon dioxide and converting it into something else, which is great. But what we're converting it to is a worse greenhouse gas, in this case methane, than originally as carbon dioxide. And so really we do have to think about the aftermath of what we might be releasing into the atmosphere if we do convert the carbon dioxide into something different, or where we're putting it and what we're doing to the natural environment there and what we might be causing if we're going to cause even worse repercussions. And so it's just things we have to think about. And I think it's an interesting example of this one. So next, Winogradsky columns. These are columns in which we can actually culture redox stratified bacterial cultures. So we do this by culturing diverse bacteria in one culture. And what happens is distinct redox layers form because at the surface, bacteria that need light to photosynthesize, such as cyanobacteria, might thrive there and then they produce oxygen. And then just below them, or also there at the surface with them, there will be bacteria that need that oxygen that they're producing in order to survive. And then you're going to get the bacteria that cannot live in aerobic environments, meaning when there's oxygen present, way at the bottom because they want to be as far away from that oxygen as they can. And then there's going to be those median bacterial species where you might have microbes that can live with oxygen but also can live without it, or that typically live without it but aren't poisoned as severely by it as the ones below them. And so you're just going to get these stratified layers of respective metabolic niches. And it's just a really cool way to understand how life works and how everything's a chain and how everything affects each other. And it's just really cool. So next, I want to discuss aquatic basin redox stratification due to lack of mixing. So in places like lakes, this can happen when a lake doesn't mix that often, and then it's called meromictic. That means it just doesn't have time of year where it mixes, and so it just is pretty stratified heavily, meaning mixing just means where oxygen-rich waters in the surface will mix with the bottom ones and oxygenate the bottom layers, and the bottom nutrient-rich water will come up and mix with the upper waters, and you'll get this nice mix of chemicals within the water that will contribute to a healthy aquatic environment. However, you can also have lakes that don't mix, and that's when you get these really heavily stratified water bodies with a lot of anoxic bottom waters, or just bottom waters with no oxygen in them, and you'll start to see different microbial communities like we talked about with different metabolic pathways form in those bottom waters that don't use oxygen because that's where they want to stay. They don't like the oxygen. And this is actually something that in early Earth was really common, is anoxic zones in the ocean, because oxygen didn't accumulate on Earth until later in Earth's history after life had evolved. And therefore, today, because Earth's ocean is now relatively well oxygenated, there isn't as much anoxic stratification going on. And so you'll see more oxygenated layers and microbial communities that can and do use oxygen rather than, for example, methanogens, unless you get really deep into the sediment. However, there are increasingly more dead zones spreading in Earth's oceans today. And so what I mean when I say dead zone is basically an oxygen depleted zone of the ocean. And what can cause this are things like fossil fuel combustion. We're taking oxygen out of the atmosphere, and most notably directly to the ocean, we're eutrophying it. And so, for example, when we have nutrient-rich waters from rivers that we put agricultural byproducts in or whatever it might be, these rivers are feeding into the ocean, and at continental margins where they're feeding into the oceans, they're causing an over nutrient rich environment where you're going to get a lot of algae growth and a lot of stagnation in the water, poor mixing, and then a lot of stratification. And what that's causing is a lack of oxygen. Beneath that algae growth, you're going to have hardly any oxygen left for the larger animals in the environment that want to breathe the oxygen, and so they're all going to leave, and those that couldn't leave fast enough are going to die, especially because this is happening at the rate that it's occurring at, a very fast rate compared to normal natural processes on Earth. It's causing just a lot of death among large oxygen-breathing eukaryotic life in the ocean near these continental margins. And so agricultural byproducts and nutrient-rich runoff into the ocean is something we should all understand and take into account when we think about environmental issues today and what we need to be acting on. So lastly, I want to point out the use of redox-sensitive elements that we can use to reconstruct ancient redox conditions, as well as project future redox conditions on Earth, in the oceans, in soil, in marine sediment, in lacustrine sediment. And so we can use elements such as oxygen, sulfur, iron, molybdenum, and many other elements that have multiple redox states that behave sensitively to redox conditions. We can use these elements to track changes in redox conditions through Earth by looking at how these elements' concentrations in sediment change, how their speciation in sediment changes, and how their isotopic composition in sediment changes. And this is all because these elements behave in differing ways in oxygenated environments versus anoxic environments versus sulfitic environments versus ferruginous environments versus nitrogenous, all the types of environments in the redox stratification slides that we mentioned, they behave differently depending on them. And so when we combine all these redox sensitive element proxies to make our reconstructions, it makes a much more accurate and precise picture of what redox conditions were really occurring. And so from this, we can reconstruct not only one redox condition based on one piece of sediment, but we can paint a picture of Earth's redox evolution through history. And it's pretty cool. And that picture isn't fully painted yet. So if this is something you're interested in or you find awesome, like I do, it's something you could look into and you could start studying as well, because we still need to paint a lot of the picture. And if you're wondering why it even freaking matters, well, it matters, man. Redox cycling and biogeochemical cycling, even if we're just reconstructing the past, matters a lot for future projections and our understanding of dynamics of biogeochemical cycles today. And biogeochemical cycles today and in the future are very important for climate change, astrobiology, environmental science, our understanding of geological processes, our understanding of microbial evolution and microbial diversity through time, as well as microbial processes today. Our understanding of pretty much everything relies on biogeochemical cycling understanding. And maybe that isn't true. Maybe there's some things that rely on physics or math, which, okay, fine. But I'm a biogeochemist, so I'm a little biased. So yes, it's awesome, it matters, and it's very important. And there are holes that we can still figure out using our knowledge of modern and past biogeochemistry. So with that, thank you so much for watching. And I hope you learned something about the redox tower, different metabolic pathways on the redox tower and their differences in redox potential and energy yields, the formation of redox stratification in natural systems, and how we can use redox-sensitive elements to reconstruct past redox conditions and make future redox projections and further our understanding of biogeochemical cycling in natural environments. Thank you again, and I will see you guys next time. Bye.